Good morning. I'd like to greet you with the watchword for today, which comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. You are no longer foreigners and aliens, but fellow citizens with God's people and members of God's household. I'd just like to highlight a few items on the list. On the announcement sheet, which I hope you've all received. You need it for the service anyway. Please keep the families of Money Gavers and Edgar Driemeyer in your prayers. And the funerals for those will be taking place next weekend. Please keep an eye out for the announcement sheet here, and also any further announcements will be made through the normal channels. I'd like to highlight the trumpet and organ concert that's going to take place here next Sunday, if my memory serves me correctly, and if I'm reading correctly. Please support that as much as possible. And then the collection for today is for the Ministry and Discipleship Fund of our greater church in Nalksa. Please support as much as possible. I'd also like to thank Pastor Ron Kuzel, who will be holding this service for us today. And I hope the Lord blesses your service with us and the greater church. Now I'll hand over to him for the continuation of the service.
Good morning, everybody. I don't think I need to be welcomed anymore. I feel like part of the congregation. Before we sing our first hymn, just a pointer, there were a couple of mistakes on this announcement sheets with the numbers and so forth. It has got nothing to do with the person who typed it. It is the computer. I am told this computer has a motherboard, and they are trying to find a computer with a fatherboard that will... I think they're more reliable. My wife isn't here, so I can talk. I will, after the first hymn, we will sing the two verses. I will do a confessional prayer that I will read to you. It was written by a very good friend of mine. Straight after that, the psalm for the day, and then we'll sing the Glory Be to God. Straight after the psalm, and then go to the rest as it is on your announcement sheets. I now wish us all God's blessing as we celebrate the service in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, you have given us a world of beauty, and we have spoilt it. A world to feed us, and so many go hungry. A world of riches, and we are unwilling to share. A world to care for, and we think only of ourselves. Forgive us, gracious God, for those times your heart is saddened by our selfishness, for those times we have no thought for others, no cares but ours. Enable us to see this world anew as a gift from you, to be shared and nurtured, and those who live upon it to be loved and cared for. We ask that your name be glorified through the beauty of this world and the service of our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story, those he redeemed from the hand of the foe, those he gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we may celebrate this service now, knowing you are present. Thank you, God, that you know us so well, that we don't have to even try to hide anything from you. You know what we need. You know when we are hungry or thirsty. Thank you for your willingness to see us and to nourish us. We pray that in this service we will receive that which we need for the coming week. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The epistle reading for today comes from Acts chapter 2, verses 41 to 47. Those who accepted his message were baptized. About 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings and to the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together at the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Here ends the epistle reading. Before we continue with the next song, there was a bit of a typo. That is not 289, it is 389 in the hymn book. That is 389. The Gospel for today comes from John chapter 6, verses 1 to 15. Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. And the Jewish Passover feast was near. When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for all these people to eat?" He asked this only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, "It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread to feed each and to have each a bite." Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "Here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?" Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." There was plenty grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves and gave thanks and distributed it to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they had all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, "Gather the pieces that are left over, let nothing be wasted." So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten. After the people saw the sign Jesus performed, they began to say, "Surely this is the prophet who has come into the world." Jesus, knowing that they intended to come and make him king by force, withdrew again to mountain by himself. Here ends the gospel reading. Let us confess our Christian faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the realm of the dead. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the dead, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Dear God, we thank you for speaking to us through your word. We also thank you for speaking to us through your servants. We ask you, open our hearts, our minds, fill them with your spirit. And we also pray, dear God, that you may fill my mouth with your spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Dear congregation, I will refer to the passages that we've heard today during the course of the sermon. I want you to imagine something, that you are a chicken and you're a free-range chicken, nochal, eh? Not just one who's in a cage, but a free-range chicken. And you're busy picking food, you know, and sometimes you scratch with your feet to find the right food and you leave that which isn't good, but you're busy eating. We call that input. Now jump in your minds, you're a chicken that has had a lot of input. Now you can lay an egg. And you lay this beautiful egg, and we call that output. Now jump a little bit more in your mind. So we've got input, output. Jump a little bit in your mind now, and you see this beautiful roasted chicken. Now, for us people, it is a good sight. Now, from a chicken's point of view, and remember, you're a chicken. Now, all we can now say is kaput. So, input, output, kaput. I would like you just to remember those three words, because I'll often refer to them during the course of the sermon. God has a very simple logic when he deals with us human beings. God gives me all the necessary input, enabling me to respond with the output that avoids kaput. I'll repeat that. God gives me all the necessary input, enabling me to respond with the output that avoids kaput. Let's look at God's input a little bit closer. God created me to be unique and special. And we know that from the Bible, it is repeated in so many sections in the Bible. And part of God's input, so we have him creating me, making me unique, making me special. And part of his other input is that he claimed ownership of me. And he demonstrated this in baptism by giving me the ability to make choices. Let's break that down a bit. He claims ownership of me. Now, there are many passages also in the Bible that confirm this, that God has taken ownership of me. And my favorite one is the one from Isaiah 43, verse 1. We didn't hear that this morning. You're just getting it because it's my favorite. Fear not, the Lord says. Fear not. For I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. God claimed ownership of me. Our watchword for today, Paul also says, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household. It is because God has claimed ownership of you and me that we allow to say we are no longer foreigners and strangers. We are members of his household. He demonstrates his love for us, his taking ownership of us in baptism. And that is also part of God's input to show us. Because in baptism, the old person dies and a new person rises, is born again. Dear congregation, for me, this is one of the greatest miracles ever. That God, when I was tiny, when I was so small that I couldn't consciously have a bad output, that God then already said to me, I accept you warts and all. And I know I'm going to have trouble with your warts and all later on in your life. I know that. But I still claim to you as my child. I own you. And I think that's a miracle. Because God knows everything. He knows what he's committing himself to. He knows that. And he takes me as I am. And he did that when I was a baby. A miracle. Now those who know me a little bit better will know that my warts and all, God has to work hard on me. Every day. Part of God's input is also to give me the ability to make choices. I may decide between right and wrong. I may decide whether I want to go left or right or straight. God has given me that ability. When he created the heavens and the earth and the Garden of Eden, we read right in the beginning of the Bible, he created human beings. And God also created the tree of knowledge. I don't want to go into detail about how is that all possible. Let's just take the message. In this beautiful garden, which God says you can have everything you want, as much as you want, he puts this one tree and says, don't eat the fruit of that tree. He puts it there. From the beginning, giving people a choice to do what they want to. The congregation, we often choose the forbidden fruit in our lives. Sometimes we only know that it was actually a forbidden fruit in hindsight. Other times we take it knowing it is the forbidden fruit. So unfortunately, there are many other inputs that influence us to give other outputs that can possibly lead to our kaput. The world, South Africa, our community is in so many ways kaput. In so many ways kaput because people are kaput. And let us be honest, you and I also at times are not what we are meant to be. We are also kaput. And we show that sometimes to others, but more often to ourselves in the thoughts we have, in the way we speak to others, and in what we do. I wonder how many words were spoken last night at the celebrations of that rugby game. And when they just lost the Springboks. I am kaput, sometimes in thoughts, in words, and in deeds. What language did I use commenting during the game, at the end of the game? Now let us look at the gospel reading. We hear that people were following Jesus because they had heard and seen that he could perform miracles. So they followed him. And he wanted to just get a little bit of a break, so he went to the other side of the lake and onto a mountain with his disciples, and there were this flock of people waiting for him. The people were hungry. The people were in need of something that the church of that time, the Jewish church, couldn't give them. And they were hungry for the Redeemer, for the Messiah. And some of them thought, maybe it is him. They were hungry. Spiritually hungry, but also physically hungry. And they didn't express that. Jesus saw it. And so he performs that incredible miracle with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And you and I can sit down and try and do the maths, and the science doesn't make sense, but let's take it as it is. 5,000 men were fed. The women and children weren't counted. More than 5,000 people were fed, and there was still left over. When we are kaput, when we are hungry, when we are in need of something, Jesus can see that. God sees it. And he can feed us with that which we need and give us the right and the good input. Do we want it? We know that God has a plan. And part of his plan was to accept us, warts and all, in baptism, to speak to us through his word, and to offer us Holy Communion. God comes alongside us through Jesus Christ and forgives us by renewing us and by strengthening us. Dear congregation, every time I go forward and I receive a piece of wafer and a sip of wine or grape juice, I'm stepping alongside God who says, I want to renew you. I forgive you. And I want to strengthen you so that you can live a life that doesn't lead to kaput. So whenever I step forward to receive Holy Communion or ask for it to be brought to me in some cases, we are in a way stepping alongside God, and we are declaring to God that we are hungry, that we are kaput, that we are in need of his intervention in our lives. We proclaim that just by stepping forward and receiving. By participating, we also come alongside each other by showing our shared need for God's intervention and willingness to support each other to avoid consuming wrong inputs. Dear congregation, you're not alone in this sinking boat that seems to be sinking at times anyway, because we are so kaput, you and I, as individuals. But by stepping forward, receiving, on the one hand, all of that which we say, God steps alongside us, we stepping alongside God, but we also stepping alongside each other and declaring, I'm in the same boat as you. I'm just as needy as you are. I'm just as kaput as you are. Together, we are going to be renewed and strengthened. Part of God's plan is to give us the church and church services. If we look at the first reading, the book of Acts, we know that the church was born with Pentecost. And the passage we heard was about that first congregation. And they came together and they celebrated. Now that they sold everything and shared it amongst each other, I don't believe that is what God is telling to us now. They believed in those times Jesus was still going to come again in their lifetime. So it's a different context. But they came together and they celebrated together. They shared each other's blessings. They celebrated. Dear congregation, just imagine Your best friend is getting married. Are you going to go to that wedding? You obviously invited because you're the best friend. Are you going to go to that wedding? And I think in most cases we would. Every one of us would. Because it's our best friend. And I want to stand alongside he or she and celebrate with them that they've found a partner. And we're going to celebrate. Now those of you who've ever been to a wedding know that celebrations can be very joyful. And spiritual on the other side, you know that spiritual with the small s. But it's fun. When we step into the church, we should be feeling like that every time. Because we are celebrating with our God who renews us, who gives input to us, who says, your kaput is not the last word, let us start again. We are celebrating with this God. And we are celebrating with each other that we have a God that is so kind and loving. So if we want to ask, why did God even have to make a plan? Why did he have to do something to try and save us? He wanted to. Because he loved us. And he wanted us to have a good output in life. And that output is to be give thanks to him and to pass on the good news of God's input to all people. That's what he wants. Give thanks. It's the only thing we can do in response to what God does to us. And we can give thanks in words and in deeds. But I cannot grab God and hug him and say thank you for what you've done to me, because I can't do that. But I can express my thanks in my prayers and by celebrating his love in our church services. The congregation, we should be sitting here with smiles as big as our ears can hold our head on top of us. Because if we weren't ears, the head would fall off. That's how we should be celebrating every time. In joy. Because we know we are loved and cared for. I want to just give a summary now. God's logic is that he gives me all the necessary input, enabling me to respond with the output that avoids kaput. God's input, he creates me to be unique and special, claiming ownership of me, demonstrating this in baptism, and giving me the ability to make choices. Our output is to pass on the good news of God's input to all people. And the amazing thing is God enables us to do this. You don't have to be a pastor or a missionary or evangelist or these fancy names given to those who are allowed to preach. He enables every one of us to do exactly this. And we can do it in words and in deeds. Where we are. Where we live, where we work, in our church services, with each other. Let us thank him for who he is to us, our God. Let us be silent and then pray together. Thank you, God, for loving each one of us so much that you see our kaput, our need for you, long before we can even express it in words. Thank you that you love us so much. Thank you that you've claimed ownership of each one of us in love. Thank you, God, that we may go into this week knowing we are never alone. You go with us. We are yours. help us to give an output that is in honor to you, that gives thanks to what you have done, that shows our thanks for what you have done through Jesus Christ in our lives. Thank you for saving us. Thank you that we may confess today with joy we are not kaput because of your grace. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God, and may the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Now the hymn that we're going to sing together now while the offering is taken is 284. There's another motherboard typo there. It's 284. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we lift this money up to you and thank you for all the blessings we receive. And we wish and ask you to accept this money as a token of our thanks, that it may be used for the good of your work in your church. We ask you to bless the hands that gave and bless the mission and discipleship work in our church. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear God, we thank you that we may be here this morning, that we may know we are loved and cared for by you. We want to thank you that we may also know it is never too late for us, that through your Son, Jesus Christ, you come alongside us again and again, in grace, forgiving us, showing us your mercy. Thank you. Father, we pray that we will be able to live this better in our lives, that others will know there's something special about each one of us because of the way we speak and treat them. Father, we pray for our country, and we ask that you give our politicians wisdom to navigate these political times that can go this way or that way. God, you know that, and we know that. But we pray that sanity will prevail amongst our politicians. We thank you for the positive signs that we are receiving with the strengthening of the rand in our economy. We pray for peace in this world, where people are fighting and destroying each other. Fill them with your love and give them the peace that only you can give. Bless this world, our country. We also pray for your blessing on your church, that your church will always be bold enough to tell the truth, but caring and loving enough to be open for everyone. We pray for pastors in our church, and we pray for your blessing on our congregation and all the wonderful things that we may experience here with each other and for each other. All this, Father God, we pray in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We will now prepare ourselves for Holy Communion as we sing together, "Create in me, God, a clean heart." It is indeed good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord. In the blessedness of your saints, you have given us a glorious pledge of the hope of our calling, that moved by their witness and supported by their fellowship, we may run with perseverance the race that is set before us, and with them receive the unfading crown of glory. And so with all the saints on earth and in heaven, and all your glorious host, We praise your name and join the unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after the supper, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with us all. Amen. Come, for all is now ready. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
vergossen. Christi Blut für dich vergossen. Christi Blut für dich vergossen. Christi Blut für dich vergossen. Deine Fassung. May the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto everlasting life. Peace be with you. Amen. Deine Fast geschieht für dich. And may the body of the health of our Lord Jesus Christ also strengthen us that we too may go in his blessing. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for this gift of mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, his body, his blood for us. May it strengthen us, may it keep us, so that we may go into this world as good servants. We pray this in your presence. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. As closing hymn, we would sing 347, number 347.